Welcome to Massive Passive Cash Flow, the podcast that guides professionals to financial prosperity. Join our community and let's start building your wealth. Here's your host, Gary Wilson.
Hi, everyone. This is Gary Wilson, and welcome to this week's Real Estate Investing for Professional Men and Women. Great podcast for you and I, business owners, professionals in our fields. And the way we invest is we all like good deals, but we don't really focus so much on the no money down strategies, although we can do that. It's just a time and place for it. It's just not every place. But I found that if I can get you on a cash basis, you'll get better deals. And then later on, you can be creative with your financing. It's just one unique strategy to help you get the best deals. So that's sort of what we're all about. If you haven't subscribed yet, please feel free to do so. This is on probably 30 some odd channels now being downloaded in over 30 countries. And if you want to be part of the community, absolutely go to myinvestmentservices.com. That's myinvestmentservices.com. Click on members area, go down to silver, you go to the silver page. You got to either log in as a member or off to the right, click on you want to check it out for free kind of thing. And the community is out there, over 4,000 strong, and we're doing joint ventures together, supporting each other all across mainly US and Canada. And if you want to be part of that, welcome aboard. So in the meantime, we bring in special guests. It's not always me doing the podcast. We have lots of special guests, different fields, different backgrounds. Most of them are also professionals in some field or another, like Mark Podolsky, who we have on today. So Mark, welcome aboard. And Mark, go ahead and fill people in on you know, who you are, like paint us a picture, and we can talk about some of the what, like some case studies and things like that. How's that sound?
Yeah, that sounds great. So, Gary, thank you so much for having me. Mm-hmm. So just to rewind the tape, I used to be a miserable, micromanaged, overstressed 45-minute commute to work and back employee. I was an investment banker, and I specialized in mergers and acquisitions with private equity groups. And Gary, I'm telling you, it got so bad for me, I wouldn't get the Sunday blues anticipating Monday coming around. I'd get the Friday blues anticipating the weekend going by really fast and having to be back at work on Monday. So my firm hires this guy, and he's telling me that as a side hustle, he's buying up raw land, pennies on the dollar. He's flipping them online, and he's making a 300% return on his investment. Well, I'm looking at companies all day long, and a great company has 15% EBITDA margins or free cash flow. Great company. Right. Average company is 10%. I'm looking at companies all day long, less than 10%. So I don't believe him. And he takes me to New Mexico. I got $3,000 saved up for car repairs. I do exactly what he says to do. I buy 10 half-acre parcels, an average price of $300 each. I flip them online. They all sell for an average price of $1,200 each. It worked, 300%. So I took all that money, went to another auction where I live in Phoenix. And again, there's no one there. It's 2,000. And I'm buying up lots. I'm buying an acreage for like nothing. And over the next 6 months, I made over $90,000 cash. So I go to my wife. I'm like, honey, I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to be a full-time land investor. She's pregnant. She's like, absolutely not. So I said, okay. So it took me 18 months for the land investing income to exceed the investment banking income. And then I quit. I've been doing it full time ever since. Since that time, I've done over 5,400 land deals, and I absolutely love it.
Nice. Well, I tell you what, you hit on a couple of key points. For by the way, I don't know if I mentioned this to you. I came from the corporate world too, in banking, and I worked on mergers and acquisitions, but I was the computer geek. I was in the room, inside the room. They never let me see light of day. All I had to do was analyze systems, compare systems, determine which one would survive, which one would emerge, things like that. And it really just, I mean, I felt like the proverbial skeleton gathering cobwebs. That's what it felt like. Finally had the guts to step out and do something about it. And investing was the answer for me too. But if you don't mind, you mentioned a couple of things there. The land, so talk about the, and maybe give us like an example or a case study. And, if you've invested also in other parts of the country, I know I've traveled over 600 cities and towns in the last 5 years teaching, and mostly similar, but there are some states that are, you know, somewhat different. They're like California's different, New Jersey, New York, Texas is easy, Florida, Georgia. And I know other people in Arizona too, and you guys are, you know, if it wasn't for not having an ocean, I'd probably be out there because you guys are doing great in Arizona. But yeah. How about like a case study or two, if you don't mind, you know?
Yeah, you know, I can give you case studies all day long, but it's not going to really paint the entire model. Let me walk you through the model. And then if you want to dig deeper into like, you know,
yes,
exact case studies we can. So let's just use you an example. So Gary, where do you live?
Florida and Ontario, Canada.
Florida and Ontario, Canada. So let's say, for example, you bought 20 acres of raw land in Texas.
Yeah.
And you owe $200 in back taxes. So I get the list from the county treasurer, the assessor, and I say, oh, there's Gary Wilson. He lives in Florida, but he owes $200 in back taxes on this property in Texas. So you're advertising two things to me. Number one, you've no emotional attachment to that raw land. You're in Florida, properties in Texas. And number two, you're distressed financially in some way because you're not paying your property taxes. And as a result, we don't value things the same way. We don't pay for them. So essentially, you're getting notices every single month from the county treasurer saying, Gary, if you don't pay your taxes, we're going to auction this property off to a tax lien or a tax deed investor. So what I'll do is I'll look at the comparable sales on that 20-acre parcel for the last 12 to 18 months. And let's just take the lowest one. Let's say it's 10 grand. And all I'm going to do is divide by four. And that's going to get me what Warren Buffett would call a 300% margin of safety. So I'm going to send you an actual offer of $2,500 for your 20-acre parcel. Now you accept it because for you, $2,500 is better than nothing. Mm-hmm. In reality, 3 to 5% of people accept my quote-unquote top dollar offer. So now you accept it. Well, now I've got work to do. I've got to go through due diligence, you know, it's in-depth research. I got to confirm you still own the property. I got to confirm the property taxes are only $200. There's been no breaks in the chain of title. There's no liens or encumbrances. In this whole property report, I outsource my due diligence to my team in the Philippines. They're connected to an American title company. It costs me about $11. Now, that's only for deals that are $5,000 or less. Now, if it's $5,000 or more, we'll just go through a traditional title company. We won't take any due diligence risk at all. So now I buy the property from you, and I'm going to sell this property 30 days or less, and I'm going to make it cash flow just like you would any renter. So Gary, I have a built-in best buyer for that property. Do you know who it is?
Who's that?
The neighbors.
Oh, okay. Neighbors.
So I'm going to send out neighbor letters saying, here's your opportunity. Protect your privacy. Expand your holdings. Protect your views. Oftentimes, the neighbors will buy it. Now, if they pass, I'll go to my buyer's list. If the buyer's list passes, I'll go to a little website you may have never heard of called Craigslist, 10th most trafficked website in the United States. I'll go to an even smaller one called Facebook, buy sell groups and marketplace. And then I'll go to the lands, landmodo.com, landandfarm.com, landsofamerica.com, landflip.com, landhub.com. These are platforms where people buy and sell raw land every single day. But the way that I'm going to sell it is where the magic happens. I'm going to make it irresistible. So I'm going to ask for a $2,500 down payment, and then I'm going to make it a car payment. I'm going to owner finance it. Let's say $449 a month, 9% interest the next 84 months. I got a one-time sale. I get my capital out on the down. I might go 6 months out, and then I'm going to get $449 a month every single month the next 84 months. No renters, no rehabs, no renovations, no rodents. Because I'm not dealing with a tenant, I'm exempt from Dodd-Frank, RESPA, and the SAFE Act. All this onerous real estate legislation. So the game that we play is, can we create enough of these land notes where our passive income exceeds our fixed expenses? And now we're working because we want to, not because we have to.
Right. Well, I like the principle there, not having a, there's no buildings and improvements on the property, so you don't have plumbing, electrical, all that stuff you got to deal with. And plus, when you have tenants themselves, you're right, there's landlord-tenant law that kicks in, and you can't just, someone who doesn't pay you, you can't just go and say, oh, so sorry, I'm going to lock the door here and you can't come back in. That's will get you in trouble. But on raw land, I imagine the process of you know, repossessing the property, which is the only right we really give over in a tenancy relationship anyways, is probably way easier. I don't know if you have any feedback on that, but when it comes, so somebody doesn't pay, is there already like a pre-confession or judgment, or what's that process look like? Should it ever happen, you know?
So what we do is we use a land contract. So the property stays in my name until they pay off their promissory note. We use a software program called geekpay.io, which is a set it and forget it system. So we get the down payment via credit card, and then we automate the payments every single month via ACH or their checking. But if the ACH should bounce or fail, we do have the credit card as a second payment method on file. So we took a default rate of 8% down to 4% using this software.
Wow. Well, that sounds pretty good. So I tell you, so now that I got the process, and I'm thinking through some, maybe what my listeners are thinking here. So let's take a teacher, fireman, policeman, maybe like a public servant, and they're busy. You know, they got, you know, people always think, well, teachers got it easy. They only work 9 months out of the year. Well, I've teachers in my family. I can tell you they put a lot of hours, and firemen, policemen, their schedules are odd. So somebody just starting off, and let's say maybe they're not even in Arizona or Texas. What can they expect, or where would they get started, or what does it look like to them? You know, 1, 2, 3, you know, maybe 3 things.
Yeah. So the last thing we want to do is build another job for ourselves.
Yeah.
So really 90% of this business is automated with software, inexpensive virtual assistants, and more software, basically. Mm-hmm. So what we do is we use a program. We get the list. We upload that list using our program. It sends out the offers. Once the offers come back, we use our team in the Philippines. But there's other companies out there. There's parcelviewer.com. There's landmasters.us that will actually do your due diligence for you as well. Now, once that gets done, you buy the property. Now, using the software, you can actually send the check via lob.com. So I don't even have to write out a check anymore. Once we're talking to our sellers, we outsource that to an intake manager as well. Mm-hmm. So an inexpensive virtual assistant. They are actually incentivized to negotiate down the price. And they get a bonus for every $100 they negotiate down. So now we record our deeds via simplifile.com. So even that makes it easier. Then we automate our neighbor letters. We use a GIS map. It's very simple to make a list doing that. We upload that list into our software. We send out our neighbor letters. But then we use inexpensive virtual assistants to write our ads. And we want to be everywhere. Then from there, we might use our acquisition manager, or if you're just starting out, you do it yourself. You're just a closer. And essentially, you just ask them, how much do you want to put down? You use geekpay.io to collect the down payment. It's a set it and forget it system that automates the back end. So we tell our clients we expect about an hour or two a day of focused work in the business. The rest of the time should be really on the business and building your machine. Our expectation is that within 12 to 18 months, you should have that machine built. I work about an hour a week in Frontier Properties. And basically, I'm just talking to my team once a week, looking at the numbers and breaking stuff. So I'll wake up one day, I have coffee. I'm like, hey, can we market on Zillow? What about OfferUp? And now I'm just, you know, everything's working fine, but now I'm breaking something with the team. They hate it.
Yeah.
So basically that's really what you want to do is build the machine. 12 to 18 months, you should have it built. Your passive should be between $10,000 to $15,000 a month by that time.
Okay. Well, just and referring to some of the reading I've done and things you publish, and so you have, you know, 3 ways to free yourself from social economic dependency. And we kind of talked about that to a degree. In other words, you've got a regular job. You're like you and I, we were, you know, basically, you know, working our lives away in the corporate world. We realized, well, we can become independent, economically independent by investing in real estate. But relative to what we talked about so far with the land, are there other strategies you might suggest to someone who's really looking to become truly independent? And, you know, maybe get out of their day job in the next 6 to 18 months. Is there 2 or 3 other things that would be complementary to buying and selling the land that you can think of?
So it depends where you are in life. Mm-hmm. Let's say you're a 20-something. You can quit your job today. You can sustain yourself on ramen noodles and do this full-time right out of the gate. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, we're only talking about the passive income piece. We're not talking about land flips where you're mm-hmm. making 300, 500%. Our margins are about 300 to 1,000% on owner financing.
Right.
So we've got a lot of people in their 20s. They're able to quit their jobs very quickly and replace their incomes very, very quickly using this model. Now, if you've got a spouse, you've got responsibilities, you have dependents, then you need to make a plan to start lowering your overhead, your personal overhead, as well as start generating passive income from day one. And just, you know, look, anyone can do anything for 12 to 18 months.
Right.
And you put your head down, you focus, and then you replace your income in that time. And then you can do what, like Roberto Chavez was a full-time attorney. He got to about $15,000 a month. Just instead of working 5 days a week, now he's working 3 days a week and has more options.
Right.
I have another client, John Burnett. He replaced 75% of his income. He retired his spouse. He literally works from home now and really just spends time with his family, but still has that other 25% piece working a little bit part-time on what he was doing as well. So it just gives you really a lot of flexibility. But I wouldn't ever tell anybody who has a wife and kids, yeah, go ahead and quit your job and start doing this full-time.
Yeah. No, I agree. I know when I got out of the corporate world, I didn't just realize, okay, I can make money in real estate and leave. Actually, it took me 18 months. I could have left much earlier, but I was just, quite frankly, I'm like pinching myself. Is this really working? I mean, am I taking a risk? What am I doing? And I just didn't really have the guts because my brain, I was so trained from the time I was little. I can remember it, to get the college degree. I'm sure you and I, we both follow the same path. You know, get a good corporate job either for 40 years and retire with a nice big giant pension. Well, those rules were changing for you and I in our time frame. And I just got to the point of like, okay, I'm just going to do it. You know, worst case scenarios, I go back to the corporate world a year later, but I never, thank the Lord, it's been now 18 years, didn't have to do that. But so let's do this. I'm getting a pretty good picture here for people. And it really does seem like at the numbers we're talking, you know, I know some listeners think, okay, well, I'm a teacher. I don't make the kind of money that dentists make or attorneys and things like that. But it doesn't seem like you really got to have a lot of money to do this. So what are some of the areas that you would suggest? Like if somebody's in California, should they be doing this in California? Should they just jump over the state line and go to Arizona, or somebody in like New York? You know, New York's a big, beautiful state. It's not all about the city. There's lots of farmland out there, but maybe it's still better for them to go down to Georgia, for example. So when it comes to geography, you know, in broad terms, what would you suggest to people in some of those bigger, even Canadians, like in Toronto and Vancouver, extremely expensive. A lot of them do invest in the States, by the way, you know. Any thoughts there as far as what areas they might want to focus on, broadly speaking, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, let's be honest, right? Nobody wakes up and thinks to themselves, boy, I'd love some raw land today in Iowa, unless you live in Iowa. So mm-hmm. we focus on the Southwest, Arizona, New Mexico, Colorado, Texas, mm-hmm. Nevada, California, Oregon, Washington, fast-growing states, and the Sunshine States. We also focus on Florida. We ignore the middle of the country. Mm-hmm. Let's face it, New Jersey, Pennsylvania. I got to go to epa.gov, make sure I'm not buying, you know, Superfund site and taking on all that liability. Plus, am I going to be able to buy any piece of property 25, 30 cents on the dollar in New York or Manhattan? These are infill lots. They're going to hire the biggest, baddest land broker they can find. They're going to sell it 100, you know, 110 cents on the dollar. So we're going to avoid those metro areas. We want to be 2 to 3 hours from the nearest city. And we want to buy that rural, inexpensive land. And that's really where this model shines. Now, we do have clients that will make bigger dollars. They might be an hour from the city, or during your, you know, when you're sending out offers, you might find a property in the path of growth, which occasionally happens. Then you just put it in your land trust. Like I have instructions to my kids: do not sell this property until you get a seven-figure offer from a developer. Right. So you find those once in a while, but the main model is you want to be 2 to 3 hours from the nearest big city in those fast growing sunshine states. And that's right. Where you're going to get your biggest buyer pool. Not that I haven't done deals in Oklahoma. I have. I've done deals in Arkansas. We have clients who've done deals in upstate New York. There's nothing wrong with those areas. I just want to focus on them. There's there's literally billions of acres of land available. And this is the most unsexy niche ever. Like, you won't go on HGTV or the DIY network and see flip this land. It's just me in front of my computer. The before picture is raw land. The after picture is raw land. So you've got no competition, no big money, no private equity groups, no hedge funds. It's a wide open market.
Yeah. Well, have you noticed, Mark, you know, I'm sure you've been through a couple of economic cycles. I mean, you came from the world of, you know, high finance and banking like I did. And I've seen, I mean, since January, well, I guess it was October of 86, they call it Black Monday, you know. I've seen four pretty good, decent cycles come through. Of course, the big one was started in late 2007 and lasted a while. But as far as timing and where we are in economic cycles, have you ever noticed an impact there, or maybe certain twists on your strategies that would work better in a market like we're in today? It seems like we're at the top or near the top versus 10 years ago when we were at the bottom. I mean, is it like, I knew for me, I always wanted to know what the economy is doing. I didn't really care what it was doing. I just wanted to know what it was doing, so I knew what strategies to apply. Is it the same thing with land, or does it work the same no matter what the economy is doing?
Yeah, I mean, land is the long tail of real estate. Mm-hmm. So you're going to see commercial and residential get hit first. Mm-hmm. And then you'll see industrial all the way down the line, and then land. So I really didn't get hit in the market until 2010, while everybody else was really getting crushed in 2008, 2009 in housing. I didn't get crushed until 2010, and it was not fun. I mean, 50% of my notes just went away.
Yeah.
So the company was profitable, but I had personally built up all this, you know, overhead. Like, I had Parkinson's law of money. So the more money I made, the more money I spent. I wouldn't recommend doing that. That was no fun. But if you're smart about your money management, this is a really nice way of taking advantage of any market. So today, it's easy to buy, it's easy to sell. I anticipate that it's going to be super easy to buy, but a little harder to sell as we go through the inevitable recession.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. It's just like, you know, it just confirms that same thing with the investing I've done. It really doesn't matter so much what the economy is doing. What matters is that you know what it's doing, and you can adjust your expectations. Like right now, like you said, it's easier to buy and sell. And in a different kind of economy, it might be, you know, easy to buy and not as easy to sell, or vice versa. So I appreciate you shedding the light. What it tells me is there's an old saying in real estate, which is most novices will say, well, I'm going to wait and buy. I'm going to wait till the market drops and I'll buy. But their old pros know, you know, it's better to buy and wait, you know.
Right.
So let's do this. One of the things you mentioned is, you know, five reasons why you should be creative and creating passive income and raw land investment. So I know we kind of covered this, but maybe do the five-step review to really anchor this to people, because I want you to share your information, any you know, book you've read, a website, something, anything people can use to learn more about this, and maybe reach out to you if you're interested in emailing people, emailing you, speaking to people. But what would you say in a review? What are the five reasons? You know, why would someone create passive income with raw land? You know,
well, you know, essentially you've got a one-time sale. You've got recurring income without any headaches. So no renters, no rehabs, no renovations, no rodents. But passive income is going to solve two of our biggest problems in life. So if we look at the first problem, is solving our money problem. Everybody needs to have enough money, essentially. So that's going to solve the first problem. The second problem, I think, is an even bigger problem and a more of an existential problem, which is time. Because once we've created enough passive income, where it exceeds our fixed expenses, we really have the freedom then to spend time any way that we like and really live our best lives. So you and I both know people that might be making millions of dollars a year, but their relationships are suffering. They don't know their kids. They live on airplanes. I mean, what good is it?
Right.
They've solved a money problem, but they haven't solved their time problem. And then we know people that live, you know, phenomenally well. They've got all the time in the world, but they don't have any money. We call them bums.
Yeah.
So that's also a big problem. We don't want to be living on the streets. So passive income is going to solve all our problems, essentially, in those ways. We're also going to protect ourselves. So anything happened in the future that might be at risk. So I had a client the other day who sells solar, and he had three really bad months. If not for the passive income his land business was generating,
right,
which was over $10,000 a month now, he couldn't pay his mortgage.
Right.
So it's going to protect you, and it's going to solve literally the two biggest problems of life.
Yeah. And really the cool thing is again, it's not like it takes a lot of money to do this. So when it comes to like the deal structure, are you finding in most cases people are just simply buying the land outright, they're paying cash or the equivalent of paying cash, maybe an ACH transfer or writing a check. And then later on, you know, of course they're selling it through, like you said, you recommend like a payment plan. But as far as the acquisition, what would you say? Is it like 90% cash or people able to use credit to buy land? Like the financial structure, what are some of the examples you've seen, you know?
Well, I mean, in real estate, you want to use other people's money for sure. But if you're just getting started, why would anybody give you money if you don't have a track record? So essentially, like I started with $3,000. My buddy Duran started with $800. I had a client who essentially just did double closings. So tells the seller, hey, it's going to take me 90 days to do due diligence and we'll close in 90 days. Well, it takes 3 days to do due diligence, if that. So essentially, he just sent out neighbor letters. Neighbor raised his hand, said, I want to buy it. So he said to the neighbor, okay, put your money down. So the neighbor puts his money down, pays off his seller, does a double close, and makes 10 grand in the process. An infinite ROI.
Right.
So, and you know, the beautiful thing about real estate is you can certainly be very creative, and same thing with your financing. But the nice thing about this is that you don't really need a lot of money to start. If you need money for mailings to start, essentially.
That's amazing. What amazes me is how much more streamlined this process is. See, most other forms of investing, traditional buying rentals, for example, it's very labor intensive and time consuming. I mean, somebody's got to look at the building and the inspection, the pipes and the electrical and the furnace and a roof. And again, then you got to go through all the leases and the rent rolls. And I mean, I've done a lot of it and I don't regret it all, but I'm listening to this. I'm thinking, man, you know, this has come up more and more in the last couple of months. I'm thinking maybe I should focus some energy on land because with the system in place. So literally, you know, you have software we can use. I mean, like I can just log it, maybe time block, an hour a day, 2 hours a day. I'm going to do this. Is that literally like, what does that look like to me? If I was to be one of your clients, do I get stuff I download on my own computer? And is it web-based? Or, I mean, this is just intriguing to me, you know?
Yeah, it's all web-based. It's a scalable model. You can do this from anywhere in the world. All you need is a laptop and an inexpensive computer and a virtual mailbox. And that's really it. If you're, you know, let's say traveling in Europe, then you'd give a local here limited power of attorney if they had to deed over any properties. But other than that, you could do it all virtually using Simplifile. You just go to Simplifile Counties and it runs itself. You have inexpensive VAs that are already trained that you can tap into. We've created all the software for you. You just follow the recipe and it works. It's amazing.
Yeah. Well, Tilly, you mentioned foreigners. I mean, I want to ask this because I know in my business, I'm noticing we've always had foreign investors in the United States. You know, sometimes across the oceans like Israel and the Middle East and even the other side of Asia. But really, a lot of Canadians are down here. But I live part-time in Canada. I'm a U.S. citizen, but I live part-time in Canada. And, I mean, they're constantly asking me, well, you know, can I help them? Where's the good deals? But are you seeing the same thing? A lot of out-of-towners and outer and people out of the country buying land in the states you mentioned, Texas, you know, Florida, Arizona. Is that like, what would you say is a percent? Oh, and by the way, sorry, I'm going to stack a question here. Are there also any special steps you need to go through to own land and buy a land in the states? I know it's possible, but I'm not a foreigner. So when I buy a land, I just buy it as an American, you know?
So a foreigner can own land, certainly. The only difference is it's not going to help them get citizenship. That's a common myth. It's like, oh, I'll buy raw land, you know, for a couple grand and it's going to help me get citizenship. It won't. And then you are going to be responsible for U.S. property taxes. So you have to pay your U.S. property taxes. Any gains that you make on your raw land is subject to FRPTA. So it's going to be 10% withholding to the United States, and then you're going to have to pay your taxes in your host country. Now, I'm not a tax attorney. I know there's some creative Okay. things that foreigners do, but that's going to be beyond the scope of this.
Yeah. I wrote a white paper one time on foreign investors, and it was more about buying improved property. Mostly, honestly, they were buying properties for their children to live in while they were going to college, university over here. That's what they were doing.
Yeah.
You know, smart move. And then when the college child graduates, maybe if they get straight A's, they get the house or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Or they sell it for profit and just keep it as an investment. Pretty smart, wise move. Yeah, and listen to this. So I understand you have a pretty cool book here. So what can people do to take this further? Because this is too easy for anybody listening. I'm basically endorsing this. This is a great way for you to plug in is something that's low barriers to entry, and you just need the guidance, like from Mark, for example. So what does that look like? How do we actually participate in this, you know?
Yeah, so I think the best place to start is, you know, does this resonate with me? You want to get educated. So I have a course called the Passive Income Launch Kit course, which is normally $97. I'd love to offer it to your listeners for free, and they can kind of get started there, and they can just go to landgeek.com/launch kit and download the course and start getting educated. For $1.99 on Kindle, you can get the Dirt Rich book as well. And I think those are two really easy places to get started. I have my own podcast called The Art of Passive Income Podcast and two others as well. But the current one is Art of Passive Income Podcast.
Okay. Well, I like that. I'll have to listen to it. So, I tell you, we're getting pretty close here. I mean, just past the 30-minute mark. But, Mark, I want to tell you how much I appreciate you taking your valuable time to do this. I know you're a busy guy, but you have so much knowledge to share. And I think I speak for a lot of listeners when I say thanks from the bottom of my heart for doing this. And for all the listeners, thank you for listening and participating. Take Mark up on his offer. It's a pretty generous. I mean, by gosh, you can't be free. And you can never have too much knowledge. I mean, I love learning, and so I appreciate this. And if you haven't subscribed yet, please feel free to do so. Real estate investing for professional men and women. And go to the website, myinvestmentservices.com. Log in, check it out, get free stuff there too. But for right now, Mark, thanks again. God bless you, all the listeners, and you, Mark, and your families. And we will see you on the next podcast.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Massive Passive Cash Flow. Be sure to go to realestatewithgarywilson.com to join our community and start building wealth today.